Hello everybody and welcome back to my kitchen island. We are going to be working on session 3 on layout design and principles. I will take you up to my craft room in just a second to show you some design principles, but before I do that, I want to cover a quick session on power layout. So power layout is something that creates memories. Get a little principle on, and you can start by using a power layout box. And what this box gives you, like your power sort boxes for your photos, it's a dark box, plastic, keep everything nice and safe, little latch strap, hold things in place so nothing's spilled at the end. And in the box comes your power sort guides. They come with 15 in the box. The technique I'm going to show you is using your album pages with these 15 so you can lay out the whole album at one go. So let's get started and I'll show you some quick tips and tricks that I use for a quick album layout session. All right, first I'm going to set my box aside because I don't need it right now. But other items you will need for this activity, I use an album page planner, which I've designed. I'll insert a clip of this, but with the album planner, it gives me a template of what I'm laying down here and I can make quick notes. Using this template, you can just use your photos and kind of sketch which photos are going to go on what section and add your page numbers, grouping your little photos, and between this and your photo box, you can possibly circumvent this part. So with my layout planner, I'll write down what items I'm having on my pages. So in addition to your power sort box, your power sort guides, your little page planner sheet, you will also be needing your photos. So I pulled out my one compartment of the photos I have left to lay out. You'll be needing any memorabilia that you've pulled out of your folders to add to your layout guides. I always bring my trimmer along in case there's something else I need. You'll need any extra paper that, in the project that you may be using, and embellishments. You can incorporate this at this stage, but it is not necessary. I always bring a sticky notepad and a pencil in case I need to make any additional notes as I'm going. So with the page planner guide, the first page is always blank because it was your left-hand page from your other side, and we're always going to start with the right-hand page. So with my principle to make these go twice as far is that for my right-hand page, I usually use an actual page. So I'm doing the Road to Hannah. So back here I have a selection of my different pages I use. For this album I've been using Sparkle, Black, and Natural. I'm going to grab some natural pages here because that is going to be my right hand side. So you can see here I have my nice cover of my Hawaii album that I've made. I've got the pages I've done thus far. I have part of the next power sort lot sitting in here, and it's showing, according to my map, that I finished my snorkel trip and now I'm starting my Road to Hannah. So the first page in my book is going to be a right-hand page. So I'm gonna sit that here. And then the next page is my double page spread. The back side of that page, I can't lay anything on it because it's buried. So I'm going to use one of my guides. So there's a right, there's a left. And left, right is a grouping together if I'm doing a double page spread. So then I'll do it again. Another left, right. Now you can see why I like my island. Left, right, left, right. Hopefully this won't take more than 10 pages to finish this album, because I am starting to, it is starting to get very full. This is the last topic. Left, right. That's right. And a left. For this album, as I was traveling, I did pick up from a craft store in Hawaii this lovely pack that will do a double page spread. And it came with the Haleakala crater already printed out, some beautiful printed pages, and some paper for matting. So that's why I said I kept my trimmer here in case I want to cut a mat right away. Also, in preparation for this trip, I know I wanted to use this lovely border maker on my page. And that one, maybe too dark on the dark. So my first page, I think I want this one as my title page with this one, and I am gonna swap out for a sparkle page. That will sit pretty. There we are, okay. Next thing we're gonna do is grab our photos. And we'll just start deciding what's going to go on what page. So this is me driving. That will be at the beginning. This is about a plant. This is at the top of the hill. View from the top of the hill. The map going up the top of the hill. Going up to the summit. So I'm just going to start by kind of grouping them as to what we see when we're walking around. And then you can shuffle your pages around. I'm going to add in, I've got the thing about the park. Let me get on this one. And I have a note to add my entry ticket from the park. That will be up here in the front. Because this album always finishes on the left-hand side, that's basically all the photos I need and the memorabilia. Now once you have everything all laid out, anything added that you're going to add to the page now, we're just going to stack them. We're going to do them in order, so we start at the bottom, going back up. And we're going to stack our pages. At a time to do your layouts. This one's here. This is the last one here. All these I had laid out before. So all these are now ready to work on. And they are going to go in my box. When I get to my workroom, this page is done. I'm ready to go on the back side, so I'll flip this one over. This page is what's on the back side. Besides, you can see this is what's on the back side. This is the front side's. Front side's done. That's the back side, and this will be the next front side. That's what goes in here. So then you can pull them out. Once they're done, you can flip them, put them on the completed side, and start pulling out your next two you're going to work on. Here. That's here. Okay. Now that we've done our power layouts, so we know how big an album we need to do and how many pages, let's get some pages done and go over some simple principle design techniques. One of my favorite late crop talks for that one was put up by Creative Memories years ago, and it was called the 7 Steps to Success. And one of the key things they had in there is they were discussing the layout in which things aren't totally cohesive and your eye is just kind of going everywhere, versus a nice layout in which you have some flow to the layout. So with this crop, I'm going to scan it, and if you request, I'll, in my description below, I'll have a link, you can ask for it and I can send you a PDF of this. But with this one here, one of the key things they're saying is developing clusters in your layouts to form a C or a Z shape to have your eyes flow through your layouts. So here's a layout that will show you a good example of clustering. All my photos are sharing a common mat, so they're all grouped together. And I have what we call in the scrapbook world, have some white space or some gaps and areas where your eye can rest, so it's not looking at everything and 10 million things coming at you at once. So here's an example of clustering, and I'm going to have you work with me and we'll put a layout together now to go over some other principles. Okay, so this page is basically done. I am going to add this last image on top of my page protector so I can have my journaling box underneath, and this is where I'm going to tell my story on this page. For my coordinating page, this is what we're going to work on today, and I've selected these photos to work with, and I've selected some extra mats. With this photo itself, there were some the whales jumping, but they were way off in the distance, and I seem to have a lot of space around my photos, and I didn't want to take too many pages, so I did crop them to fit. Now with this one here, you'll notice when I did crop the photos, I made sure that my spacing was even so that my horizon stayed pretty much the same throughout my photos on these one. Okay, so this is gonna go on the page. Now the rule of thumb with your pages is that smaller elements will go to the top of the page and bigger, heavier elements will flow to the bottom of the page. So that would go down here. And then I have two more as well. The captain is looking up at the sky and we've got more of a roof there. So if I have the roof at the bottom of the page, you'll wonder why these people are sitting on the roof. So I'm going to slide that to the top of the page and you can just imagine, your eye will tell you that there's more roof going that way. This photo will have to be cropped. This photo I'm going to place down here on this side, and when I am placing my photos, again for my cohesiveness of my layout, I am going to line up my horizon so it gives you that visual line going across, although I will crop the photos a bit. Alright, another rule of thumb when you're doing your photos is you want your bigger, heavier objects to flow to the bottom. Now, because I want my theme to rule, which is another principle, let your theme trend your thing. We're out in the water, so I have this nice watery paper. So I actually want to use the watery paper on this layout as well. So I'm going to slide these off onto the watery paper and look at the difference it makes. It kind of throws things off a little bit, and you'll see that the background of this paper is a little bit busy, and because the print in the paper is a little bit large, your eye kind of gets drawn to the background of the paper. So to isolate it and keep things encapsulated and keep you focused on your layout, we are going to be matting our photos. So I'm just going to show you really quickly what the difference of a mat does to this photo. Also, once you find your photos, you want to have a key photo. And I always recommend matting a photo that you may want to take off the page again and use somewhere else. So let's say this photo, if we're doing a wedding or some celebration and I want to take this off my layout and scan it again for this event, if I have it matted on the page, it's easy to pop it off and not damage the photo. So you may tear the paper a bit, but you put a new mat underneath and you're good to go again. So you can see the difference here. So this is straight on the page, and this is using a mat on the page. And it now it complements and it stands out really nicely. So that one's gonna sit there. And this one's gonna go here. Again, we're gonna go with the horizon. I can do that and leave that straight on the page, or I can mat that one as well. Actually, I kind of like that now. Let me just go over and run it here. Now, when you're looking at your photos in terms for cropping your photo, these two aren't going to fit on the page together unless I overlap them again, which I don't really want to do. So when you're cropping a photo, you're not cutting a photo to make it as small as you can. You want to crop your photo to enhance your focal point on the photo. So in this photo, my little captain there is more towards the center of the photo. But if you're looking at your rule of thirds when you're taking a photo, sometimes in your camera, you can put out that grid that will put your lines across your camera, and it will show you where your focal thirds are. So if I cut this photo to make it small to fit my page, and I cut it here, it's kind of confusing that I just have all this wires around him and it looks like he's in jail almost. But he's looking off into this distance, so you kind of want to see what he's looking at. So if I crop my photo from this side, again, now my visual line is he's looking off into the distance, and the photo makes sense in this regard. I don't really need this part in the photo at all, so I'm going to take it out, and then this one will fit. And then you can say he's out looking at my whales that are jumping, and he's going to take us there. So over here, if I was going with my rule of thirds, I'm going to take off my back part of my photo. So I'll probably take it down to 5 inches. And then if I mat him here, I might use a small mat for him because he's got better emphasis. And that goes here, then my wheels will be here. I can line up my horizon as well, but because he's looking off a bit higher, I may just leave this up. And again, this one will be down and this one will be up. So rule of thumb with your photos is you don't want to, if you have a busy background, you'll want to be matting things. You want your bigger, heavier objects falling to the bottom of the page, and you want your horizons and your skies and your up and down to help things flow as well. Another point I want to make is if you're putting photos on your page for balance, if I had my island over here and my people here, it just looks funny, you see, because even if I lined up my water, because I've got my mountain kind of dead in the middle. So for cohesiveness, these people are going to be looking in this way. Again, if I wanted my captain to be down low on the page and I had these two like this, it looks like my people are fighting because they've got their backs to each other. Whereas if I slid them this way on a page, they're kind of looking into each other, and it gives more cohesiveness to the page as well. So when you're looking and placing items on your page, you do want to watch for orientation, horizons, roofs. Again, bigger, heavier. If I'm going here, these people are sitting on top of him, he's smaller, so I always tend to put the bigger, heavier items at the bottom, lighter ones at the top. So here's my completed layout. So I'm going to go over a quick session summary, because this session we're just covering power layouts and basic layout design. So in upcoming sessions, I'm going to go over journaling, embellishments, and using borders, and specific concerns for layout design in terms of too many photos, different paper, etc. So recap for this one, use a power layout or an album page planner to help organize your large project. It'll make it easier to break it into smaller pieces, so it's easier for you to understand. use your best photos so you have nice things to work with. When you're cropping your photos, it's not about how small you're going to make the photo, but putting focus to the photo that you're cropping. Each page should have a focal point, and you can matte a key photo to bring up that focal point. This one here, you can see I have a larger matte than the other ones. Your eye will draw to that one. And again, your key photos, if you need to move it somewhere else, if it's matted, less chance of damaging it if you have to take it off a page. You're going to use lines through your layouts to give direction how you want your eyes to flow. We'll be clustering photos together so they're not spaced out everywhere, making things confusing. We're going to create dead spaces in our page so your eyes can rest. When you're using your paper selection, you're going to be conscious of the size and the dynamics of the background paper you're using. So you may have to matte photos. The subjects in your photos and the size of your subjects can vary your layout. Do not hesitate to use scrapbooking resources to help you with your layout designs. CMTV, Pinterest, using sketches. I'll post some links in the description of places you can look to help you with your layouts. So we'll see you in session 4 with some specific layout design hints.